एक मैथ्स में स्टेक उठ करना ना चाहिए नहीं एंड हाँ बहुत मज़ा गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स टुडे विल डिस्कस ऑन माइक्रोबायोलॉजिकल पर्सपेक्टिव्स ऑफ मेनिंजाइटिस ओके टुडेस टॉपिक इज मेनिंजाइटिस एंड विल डिस्कस अबाउट द माइक्रोबायोलॉजिकल पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ मेनिंजाइटिस सो व्हाट इज मेनिंजाइटिस meningitis means inflammation of meninges what are meninges they are the membranous covering of the brain okay brain and spinal cord meninges means they are membranous covering of the brain and spinal cord there are three layers of meninges you know that it is dura mater arachnoid mater and pia mater these are the three layers of meninges and the inflammation to these layers of brain layers or meninges is called meningitis. Inflammation of this layers or meninges is called meningitis. And what is the function of these meninges? They provide support to framework for brain and cranial vasculature. That is the function of meninges. And if these meninges get the inflammation, it results in meningitis. And you know about cerebrospinal fluid. What is the cerebrospinal fluid? It is a clear, colorless body fluid found in brain and spinal cord. Where it is produced? It is produced by the specialized cells, which are present in the choroid plexus of ventricles of brain. Okay. So these are the choroid plexus from the third ventricle, lateral ventricle, and fourth ventricle. CSF is produced in the choroid plexus of the ventricles of the brain. Cerebrospinal fluid is produced. And why we need to know about this meninges and cerebrospinal fluid is that the inflammation to this meninges is called meningitis and it is caused by various meningitis is caused by can be caused by bacteria or fungi or viruses like that. We'll discuss about it now. And to detect those pathogenic organisms, we need to collect the sample, this one, cerebrospinal fluid. We need to collect cerebrospinal fluid. That will be the sample for diagnosing meningitis. That's why a small point on cerebrospinal fluid. Then there is blood-brain barrier. You know about this blood-brain barrier. So there is a difference between normal vasculature and the blood-brain vessels. In blood-brain vessels or blood-brain barrier, there is a tight junctions or tight junctions or no absence of pores in the vasculature of the brain. Blood-brain vessels. So, because of this tight junctions or because of the absence of pores, there is selective permeability. So, all the substances are not flow or doesn't flow easily into the brain vasculature when compared to normal blood vessels. In normal blood vessels, there are pores so that the substances pass freely through these pore passages. But whereas when you see the vasculature of the brain or blood vessels of the brain, there are tight junctions or there are some other cells called pericytes or astrocyte foot process. All these structures, what they do is they don't allow the substances to easily flow into the brain. So they guard as walls so that all the substances or these pathogenic organisms, different viruses or bacteria, they don't easily get into the brain vasculature because of this blood-brain barrier. Now we'll go into the topic, what is meningitis? So it is the inflammation of the meninges surrounding the brain and spinal cord. In true sense, it implies only to infection to leptomeninges. Leptomeninges means only arachnoid and pia mater. Here we have seen meningeal layers are three. Arachnoid mater, pia mater, and dura mater. But in true sense, meningitis implies only to inflammation of arachnoid and pia mater, but not the outer covering, that is dura mater. So it doesn't include, dura mater is not included. Only the inflammation of the arachnoid and the pia mater includes this meningitis. Etiological classification is there. That means meningitis can be classified into types basing on the etiology. It is pyogenic meningitis, when meningitis is caused by mainly bacterial, and it is caused by bacterial agents, it is called acute pyogenic meningitis or pyogenic meningitis. When the etiology is mainly of viral origin and less commonly and less few causes of bacteria or fungi or parasites, it is called aseptic meningitis. When it is caused by mycobacterium tuberculosis, it is called tuberculous meningitis. So depending upon the etiology or the causative agent, meningitis is classified into pyogenic meningitis, aseptic meningitis and tubercular meningitis. Pyogenic meningitis is caused by bacteria. Aseptic meningitis is predominantly caused by viruses and less commonly by some few bacteria or fungi or parasites. It is called aseptic meningitis. And tuberculous meningitis is caused by mycobacterium tuberculosis. In pyogenic meningitis, you see elevated polymorphonuclear cells. Polymorphonuclear PMNL cells means neutrophils. You see predominant neutrophils in pyogenic meningitis. In aseptic meningitis, you see predominant lymphocytes. Lymphocytes are elevated. When you see about the leukocytes, you know there are PMNs, that means polymorphonuclear nuclear cells, that means neutrophils and lymphocytes. In bacterial meningitis or pyogenic meningitis, there is predominant neutrophils seen in the cerebrospinal fluid. In aseptic meningitis, there is elevated lymphocytes in the cerebrospinal fluid. Aseptic is the term which is usually, it is frequently a misnomer, because aseptic means we think that there is no infection. It implies that there is no pus cells are absent in this etiology when it is caused by viral etiology. That's why it is called aseptic meningitis. It includes lymphocytes are elevated, WBC is in WBCs, lymphocytes are elevated, but there is absence of pus cells. That's why it is termed as aseptic meningitis. So what are the different causes of pyogenic meningitis? I said pyogenic meningitis is caused by bacteria. So what are the different bacteria that cause pyogenic meningitis? It is classified depending upon the age, in neonates or in children or in adults and in elderly people. So there are different bacteria causing meningitis in different age groups. When the child is very small, or in a neonate or infant, from birth to 2 months of age, it is mainly caused by bacteria E. coli or Escherichia coli and group B streptococcus or streptococcus agalactiae and other GNB like Klebsiella pneumoniae and Listeria monocytogenes. These are the common bacteria that cause meningitis in neonates. In neonates up to 2 months of age, in infants up to 2 months of age, it is main cause is E. coli, Escherichia coli, and Listeria monocytogenes also. Again, in elderly, when you see in elderly people above 60 years, again Listeria monocytogenes is the common bacteria that cause meningitis. And in children from 2 years to up to 20 years, the most common etiological bacterial etiological agent is Listeria meningitis, Haemophilus influenza, Streptococcus pneumoniae. And in adults about 20 years, again the most common agent is Streptococcus pneumoniae, then comes Haemophilus influenza and Listeria meningitis. So pneumococcal and meningococcal meningitis is common from 2 years to 20 years. Or in adults also, the main etiological bacterial agent that cause meningitis is pneumococcal. Pneumococcal and meningococcal, both are there, both are common. And then besides that, even Haemophilus influenzae can also cause meningitis. When you see the viral etiology, so what are the viruses? It is seen especially in aseptic meningitis. Viral etiology is seen in aseptic meningitis. So these are the causes of aseptic meningitis. Aseptic meningitis is mainly caused by viruses and some few causes of few other organisms like bacteria, parasites and fungi are also included in aseptic meningitis. So what are the viruses that cause meningitis? Means enteroviruses. It includes poliovirus, echovirus, Coxsackie virus. These are the most common agents, and less commonly by herpes simplex virus. Then myxoviruses also sometimes, mainly they cause respiratory infections, influenza, para-influenza virus, mumps virus, and arboviruses, adenoviruses, rubella viruses, and sometimes HIV viruses. These are the causes of aseptic meningitis. Most common agent is enterovirus, that is poliovirus, echovirus, Coxsackie virus. When meningitis is caused by tubercular bacteria like Mycobacterium tuberculosis, it is called tubercular meningitis. And the other cause of aseptic, bacterial cause of aseptic meningitis includes Treponema pallidum and Leptospira. And parasites like Neisseria, Acanthamoeba, Toxoplasma are also included, which cause aseptic meningitis. And fungi like Cryptococcus neoformans can cause aseptic meningitis. So these are the etiologic agents. In fungi, it is caused by Cryptococcus. Parasites which cause meningitis include Naegleria species, Acanthamoeba, Toxoplasma gondii. Meningitis caused by tuberculosis, Mycobacterium tuberculosis is called tubercular meningitis. Okay. So how this pathogenesis is happening? So what is the root of infection? How this, you know, the different causes of meningitis like bacterial meningitis, viral meningitis or aseptic meningitis, how these organisms are entering into the human body. So there are different routes of infection. It can be hematogenous spread or blood spread, or directly from the infected site the organisms can enter. So hematogenous spread is the, or blood spread is the most common route. Hematogenous spread is the most common route, and which cause meningitis. The organisms can enter into the oropharynx or nasopharynx. From there, from that site, they reach the bloodstream and they cause bacteremia or viremia. And then they enter through the bloodstream, they enter into the choroid plexus and reach the meninges like that. That is the blood spread or hematogenous spread. Or sometimes directly from the infected site, the organisms can reach the target site, that is to the meninges. What is the target site? Meninges. So from infected site to meninges, how they spread is directly from the infected site. So as the ear is very close to the brain, so the ear is very close. So infections in the ear, like otitis media, mastoiditis, sinusitis, it results in, if it is not properly treated, if these ear conditions are not properly treated, it results in complications and finally they land up in meningitis. And the other cause, other route of infection is any anatomical defect in central nervous system as a result of surgery or trauma or congenital defect, it results in meningitis. Then sometimes direct intramural spread can also happen, which along through the nerve. It happens, it is the least common route. It happens in case of rabies virus or herpes simplex virus infection. Through the nerve root, the virus can reach the meninges. So these are the different routes of infection. First one is blood spread, then direct spread from the infected site. In case complicated otitis media or mastoiditis or sinusitis or any anatomical defect, or through the nerves, which is the least common route, which happens in rabies virus or herpes simplex virus infection. What are the predisposing factors for meningitis? So in the age group, when you see, neonates are more prone, or they have the high prevalence because of the immature immune system they have. Because of their immature immune system, they are more, neonates are have the highest prevalence of meningitis, acquiring the, they get these organisms from the mother's birth canal. So neonates, they acquire the E. coli, this bacteria E. coli from the mother's birth canal, and they have the highest prevalence because of the immature immune system, and even the permeability of blood-brain barrier is not well developed for neonates. That's why they are more prone for meningitis. Neonates are more prone for meningitis because of the immature immune system, and they can acquire this agents, bacterial agents from the mother's birth canal itself, that is E. coli. You know, in neonates, the most common bacterial etiological agent is Escherichia coli, which is acquired from mother's birth canal, and the blood-brain barrier is also not well developed in neonates. That's why they are more prone for meningitis. And vaccination, if you children, you know, in universal immunization schedule, there is a vaccine for Haemophilus influenza. So that's why the incidence of meningitis due to Haemophilus influenza is decreased because of the vaccination taken given in the universal immunization schedule. That's why, because of that, meningitis caused by Haemophilus influenza has decreased. Then factors that promote infection primary site. So meningitis usually it results as a complication to some other primary infection. So the primary infection can be a respiratory infection. It can be a respiratory infection. So the factors that predispose to respiratory infection is also a predisposing factor for meningitis. So alcoholism, diabetes, immunosuppression, splenectomy, these all conditions, they predispose to respiratory infection. So in this immunosuppressed condition, the patient acquires this respiratory infection due to different bacteriological agents. And if this respiratory infections are not cured properly, it results again, it ends up in complication and can result in meningitis. Or the secondary spread or secondary infection to the meninges can happen and results in meningitis. Other predisposing factors are to meningitis are presence of cerebrospinal fluid shunts. When there is, that is one cause which is a predisposing factor for meningitis. When there is a breach in the blood-brain barrier because of the loss of capillary integrity, when there is a breach in this blood-brain barrier, then it can result in meningitis. And sometimes microbial virulence factors also play a role in the to cause meningitis, like capsular polysaccharide, lipoteichoic acid, IgA proteases. These all play a role, which are the virulence factors play a role in the meningitis to occur. So these are the predisposing factors. Neonates are more prone. Vaccination has a role in avoiding or preventing meningitis. And factors that promote primary infection, that is immunocompromised people are more prone to respiratory infection, and they have the chances, and those people are prone for meningitis. And presence of CSF shunts, those who are having CSF shunts are more prone for meningitis. When there is a breach in blood-brain barrier, they are more prone for meningitis. And microbial virulence factors also play a role in meningitis. So when you see the clinical manifestations, what happens when a person suffers with meningitis? So important symptom is he has a high-grade fever followed by vomiting. There will be intense headache, photophobia, intolerance to bright light. And the important signs you observe for meningism includes meningeal irritation, neck rigidity. There will be neck stiffness. The patient will be unable to bend his neck. It is called neck rigidity, or there will be neck stiffness, and there will be Kernig sign and Brudzinski's sign. Kernig sign means the patient will be unable to extend his legs when the hip is flexed. That is called spasm. He'll feel spasm in his hamstring muscles. That is Kernig sign. And Brudzinski's sign, he will be having pain in the neck when the stiffness in the neck is called Brudzinski's sign. When he flexes this hip region, he will have the pain in the neck region. That is called Brudzinski's sign. Now, how will we diagnose this meningitis in the laboratory? What samples you need to collect, and how will you diagnose in the laboratory is our topic now. So what is the important sample we need to collect? Cerebrospinal fluid is the most ideal specimen. Other samples can also be collected when the person is having high fever. Then you can take the blood for blood culture. Serum can be collected for antibody or antigen detection. And urine sample can also be collected for antigen detection. But the main sample is cerebrospinal fluid. So how is cerebrospinal fluid collected? By process called lumbar puncture. So you do this method, lumbar puncture, you collect the cerebrospinal fluid. You have to clean this area. You have to place the patient in this position. First, you should in a bent position, he should be placed on the couch, and you have to cleanse this area near L3, L4. Near lumbar discs L3, L4, you have to clean with spirit or ethanol. Then with the help of a syringe, you have to collect the cerebrospinal fluid by placing the needle in between L3 and L4. That is called spinal tap. So like that, you collect the cerebrospinal fluid. And this is the most precious sample. Cerebrospinal fluid, it is called as a precious sample. Only few drops are collected. Sometimes you get only few drops. With that only, you need to do the diagnosis. So it is the most precious sample and it should be examined immediately. We collect this cerebrospinal fluid in three containers. You have to collect CSF in three containers, and one container is sent to biochemistry for biochemical analysis. One container is sent to pathology for cell counts, and one container to microbiology department for culture. So we have to collect, when you do the lumbar puncture or spinal tap, we have to collect the cerebrospinal fluid in three containers, and it should be sent to the three departments for biochemical analysis, for cell count to pathology department, and for microbiology department, we do culture. And you should not delay. The sample is a precious sample and it should be examined immediately. And if delay is anticipated, then the sample should be preserved in incubator. It should not be placed in refrigerator. It should never be stored in refrigerator, but it should be placed in incubator at a temperature of 37 degrees centigrade. Because why it should not be placed? Usually we preserve the samples in refrigerator because the Haemophilus influenza is a delicate organism. It gets killed when it is placed in a refrigerator. That's why it should be, the CSF sample should be placed only in incubator at 37 degrees centigrade. If more delay if there is more delay in the transport, then you have to collect the sample in transport medium. That also will be there. If the lab is near, you can directly collect in the container and take to the laboratory. If the laboratory is in a far place, then you have to collect the cerebrospinal fluid in transport medium. Okay, in transport medium, and then you should take to the laboratory. And immediately it should be examined. And if you want to isolate viruses, then you have to preserve the sample in the freezer or in low temperatures, or in minus degrees, you have to preserve the sample if you want to isolate viruses. So what are the different changes or biochemical analysis? What are the changes you see in different types of meningitis? We'll discuss now. Biochemical analysis and cell count CSF. With this, you get the preliminary clue. With the biochemical analysis and cell count of cerebrospinal fluid, we get a clue that whether it is a pyogenic meningitis or bacteria or viral meningitis or aseptic meningitis or tubercular meningitis, we can get a clue with the biochemical analysis and cell count of the cerebrospinal fluid. So what happens in case of acute pyogenic meningitis? In acute pyogenic meningitis, pressure is highly elevated. So in bacterial meningitis or acute pyogenic meningitis, the pressure, CSF pressure, is elevated, and the neutrophils are elevated or predominant in pyogenic meningitis. Neutrophils are more. That is, polymorphonuclear cells are more in pyogenic meningitis. They are highly elevated. They range from 100 to 10,000 per mm cube. Usually in normal cerebrospinal fluid, per mm cube, there will be 0 to 5 leukocytes. Only there will be 0 to 5 leukocytes per mm cube. But in acute pyogenic meningitis, these neutrophils are elevated and they will be seen 100 to 10,000 per mm cube. More number of neutrophils are seen in acute pyogenic meningitis. Glucose content is decreased to absent, less than 40 mg per dl, and total proteins is elevated. Up to 45, it is normal. In normal cerebrospinal fluid, up to 45, proteins are normal. But in acute pyogenic meningitis, it goes beyond 45 mg per deciliter. So, what is the important clue to suspect that it is acute pyogenic meningitis? Pressure is elevated, CSF pressure is elevated. And mainly you find neutrophils is highly elevated. Neutrophils are highly elevated in acute pyogenic meningitis. And it ranges from 100 to 10,000 neutrophils per millimeter cube. In tuberculous meningitis, what you see is lymphocytes are elevated. Lymphocytes, there in a bacterial pyogenic meningitis, neutrophils are elevated, but in tubercular meningitis, lymphocytes are elevated and they are moderately elevated. Not too high lymphocytes, the count is not like 10,000, more than 10,000 like that. They are moderately elevated. Lymphocytes are moderately elevated and the CSF pressure is also moderately elevated. And you can see cobweb phenomenon or cobweb coagulum in the sediment or deposit, because there will be increase in proteins. The total proteins, so you see marked increase in proteins. Because of this protein increase, when you keep the CSF sample like that, you can see the cobweb coagulum. See, because of this protein, high protein content, you can see the cobweb coagulum in the base, in the test tube, or when you in the container, you can see a clot. When you keep aside the CSF for some time, you can see this clot form, that is called cobweb coagulum, which is due to the elevated protein content in case of tubercular meningitis. In case of viral meningitis also, neutrophils are not elevated, only lymphocytes are elevated more. Protein content may be normal or slightly elevated. Glucose level is normal, CSF pressure is mildly elevated. Only in pyogenic meningitis, the pressure is more, glucose also is, cells are also more in pyogenic meningitis. In viral meningitis and tubercular meningitis, there is moderate increase in the cells you can observe. Then, next step is that is biochemical analysis, cell counting. It is done with the cells at C. It is done in pathology department, the cell counting. And in if you want to observe this CSF microscopy, you have to first do the gram stain. How will you do this gram stain for a CSF sample? You have to first do centrifugation. Centrifugation you have to do for 5 minutes like that. Then supernant is used for other purpose. You have to take the sediment. After centrifugation of the CSF sample, you have to take the sediment, and with the sediment you do the gram stain and observe under the microscopy. If centrifugation is not done, the CSF sample is taken as a heaped smear. Heaped smear means 2 to 3 times or 5 times. Up to 5 times you can take 5 drops of CSF on the slide. That is called heaped smear, and you can do the gram stain. Like that, from the CSF sample, you take the CSF sample on the slide and you do the gram stain and observe for the organisms. And if tubercular meningitis is suspected, then you go with the Zeal-Linson staining. If it is the fungal meningitis, then you have to do India ink preparation. The CSF sample is mixed with the India ink and you observe under the microscope. Then you can see this capsulated fungi, that is cryptococcal neoformans, under the microscope. If it is the parasitic origin, if the Naegleria is suspected, then you do wet mount preparation. That means CSF sample is taken on a slide with a cover slip and observed under the microscope. Then you can see the trophozoites of parasites such as Naegleria. That is wet mount preparation. That is direct microscopy with the help of direct microscopy by doing Gram stain or Zn stain or inane preparation or wet mount. You can have an idea of the what organism is the etiological agent for meningitis. So Streptococcus pneumonia, when you observe this under the microscope, it is seen as gram-positive cocci in pairs with the lancelet-shaped. Streptococcus pneumonia appears as lancelet-shaped gram-positive cocci. And how will you identify the Streptococcus pneumonia in culture? It is alpha-hemolytic organism, and in colony, you can see the draughtsman-shaped colony on blood agar. And it is sensitive to optogen. These are some culture identification points. It is sensitive to optogen. It is bile soluble and it ferments inulin. Those are the identifying features of Streptococcus pneumonia. It is alpha hemolytic and it is sensitive to optogen. Those are the with those identifying features we can identify that it is Streptococcus pneumonia. And the other etiological agent is Streptococcus agalactae. It is gram-positive cocci in short chains. It is also gram-positive cocci. Pneumonia is seen in pairs. Agalactae is seen as short chains. It is the most common etiological agent in neonates. And it is beta-hemolytic, giving pinpoint colonies on blood agar. When you do this identification methods, it is a CAM test is positive and it is resistant to bacitracin. In culture, we do these tests, CAM test, Christy Atkins Munch Petersen test, it is positive. And on blood agar, you can keep this bacitracin disc to check for sensitivity. If it is resistant to bacitracin, you can suspect that it is Streptococcus agalactae. Then other common etiological agents, bacterial agents are Neisseria meningitidis, Haemophilus influenza, E. coli. Neisseria meningitidis, it is seen as gram-negative cocci, which occurs in pairs. It is intracellular. Intracellular means within the pustules, you can see this gram-negative cocci. And in culture, it is oxalase positive. The important points of Neisseria meningitidis, it grows only on chocolate agar and it is oxalase positive. Influenza, Haemophilus influenza is pleomorphic. That means it is small-sized to long-sized gram-negative bacilli. You can see the satellitism for Haemophilus influenza on blood agar. Satellitism means when grown along with Staphylococcus aureus, it gives large colonies near to the staph aureus streak. Haemophilus influenza is grown well. Whereas to the periphery, you can see small colonies of Haemophilus influenza. But near to the staph aureus, large colonies are seen because of the this factor. For the growth of Haemophilus influenza, it requires factor 5 and factor 10. And that is available for it in from Staphylococcus aureus. That phenomenon is called satellitism. E. coli, it is seen as gram-negative bacilli. How will you identify E. coli from the culture? Pink colonies, lactose fermenting colonies are seen on Meconchia agar. And you can do other biochemical tests like Imvic test to identify Escherichia coli. So these are some identifying feature, tests of identification for bacterial agents, common bacterial agents. That is Streptococcus pneumonia, Streptococcus agalactae, Neisseria meningitis, Haemophilus influenza, and E. coli. By seeing this lancelet-shaped bacteria, gram-positive cocci, you can suspect it is Streptococcus pneumonia. And it is confirmed with the blood agar, how alpha-hemolytic colonies on blood agar and optogen sensitivity. Then you can conclude it is Streptococcus pneumonia. Then GPC in chains, you can suspect it is Streptococcus agalactae. Then it is beta-hemolytic pinpoint colonies and resistant to bacitracin. Okay. Then Neisseria meningitidis, intracellular gram-negative cocci are seen for Neisseria. It is oxidase positive. Growth is seen on chocolate agar. For Haemophilus influenza, it is gram-negative pleomorphic bacilli. And you can confirm with this culture method, that is satellitism. E. coli, gram-negative bacilli, lactose fermenter on Meconchia. So these are some tests of identification for different bacteria in the culture. And fungi, if you suspect a Cryptococcus neoformans, then CSF sample is treated with India ink. Then under the microscope, you can see budding yeast cells with refractile capsule. you can do. Agglutination test is also available. You can do with the help of CSF sample, latex agglutination test for detecting the capsular antigen which is present in CSF. And how will you identify the cryptococcus growth? You can in culture, you can grow the organism on Sabros dextrose agar, where you can see mucoid white colonies. Cryptococcus grows as mucoid white colonies on Sabros dextrose agar. Okay, viral meningitis direct demonstration cannot be done directly under the microscope. You cannot observe the virus. Then you can go for nucleic acid detection, that is PCR or real-time PCR or polymerase chain reaction for CSF sample. You can detect the nucleic acid DNA or RNA in case of viral meningitis. Tubercular meningitis direct demonstration can be done by doing ZN staining or Z-Nielsen staining. You can observe the ZN bacilli, acid fast bacilli under the microscope from the CSF sample. Is treated with the CSF sample. You can do the ZN staining to the CSF sample and you can observe the acid fast bacilli. And nucleic acids can be detected. Nucleic acid from the CSF sample can be detected by PCR or by gene expert. Culture, you can, for tubercular meningitis, you can do the culture by growing the organism on LJ medium, Lowenstein-Jensen medium. You see rough, tough, buff colonies. And on MGIT tube, growth on MGIT, mycobacterial growth indicator tube, there is growth. Okay, those are the culture methods, LJ medium and growth on MGIT. What is MGIT? Mycobacterial growth indicator tube. You can observe the growth. That is about the culture methods we have seen till now. Usually the organisms, they don't grow commonly on normal media, on routine media like nutrient agar like that. They require enriched media like chocolate agar and bread agar. So for growing the organisms, you require enriched media, chocolate agar and bread agar. Sometimes you can use for blood culture, you can do in brain heart infusion broth. In brain heart infusion broth, you can inoculate the CSF sample and do the blood culture. And you can confirm or you can do tests of identification after growth is seen on the blood agar or chocolate agar. You can proceed with the biochemical test, different biochemical tests depending upon the type of organism you get in the culture. You can proceed with the biochemical test for identification, and you can keep the antimicrobial susceptibility testing. That also you can do for knowing the which drugs are sensitive to that organism. And fungal culture you do on Sabros dextrose agar. If cryptococcus is suspected, then you can use birdseed agar or Niger seed agar, which is a selective media for growing cryptococcus. The sample, CSF sample, is inoculated on birdseed agar or Niger seed agar. Viral culture, it can, when aseptic meningitis or viral meningitis is suspected from the biochemical analysis, then you can go to viral culture, can be done by growing this, by inoculating the CSF sample in appropriate cell lines. Cell lines you can use and you can proceed for viral culture. Antigen detection methods are also available. So after centrifuging the CSF sample, the sediment, with the sediment you do the gram staining and culture method. But with the supernatant or with the supernatant, it is after centrifugation you can do this antigen detection or antibody detection. Latest agglutination tests you can do for Cryptococcus neoformans. Formats are available. Latest agglutination test formats are available for detecting Cryptococcus, Streptococcus pneumonia, Streptococcus agalactiae, Neisseria meningitidis, Haemophilus influenzae, which is an easy method. Culture, it takes time. With this agglutination test, easily and within less time and immediately you can get a confirmation regarding the etiological agent. So you can proceed with, you can start the empirical treatment. So to start the treatment, you can go with this antigen detection methods. You do with the, you do these antigen detection methods from the supernet after centrifugation. The CSF sample after centrifugation, you get the supernet. With that supernet, you can do this antigen detection methods for different organisms. From urine also, you can do this antigen detection, and that is the immunochromatographic test. You can detect Streptococcus pneumoniae and Cryptococcus neoformans. By latex agglutination, the sample can be urine. Not only CSF, from urine also you can detect this different bacteria or fungi. Serological tests like antigen antibody detection can also be done. Antibody detection in serum may be useful for diagnosis of underlying viral etiology. In case of viral etiology, direct demonstrations cannot be done. If it is a bacteria, easily we can identify under the microscope by doing gram stain. But if it is a viral etiology, direct demonstration cannot be done. Then you have to go with the antibody detection. So you have to do the serological tests. For example, human herpes simplex virus can be detected, serum antibody can be detected by doing, for detection of this herpes simplex, you can go with this serological test for viruses. It is done mainly for viral detection. And bacterial endotoxin detection assay, it is called limulus lysate assay. When the patient is treated, partially treated, then you cannot, and then you get a negative culture. When the culture is negative, because of the partial treatment given to the patient, then you can go with this bacterial endotoxin detection assay or limulus lysate assay. Limulus is an antigen taken from a horseshoe crab. So when you mix with the serum, patient's serum containing bacterial endotoxin, a clot or coagulum is formed. That is called bacterial endotoxin detection. That patient serum will be having this bacteria along with the endotoxin. So when it's mixed with the limulus or an antigen present, antigen taken from a horseshoe crab, it will form a clot. That is a limulus lysate assay or bacterial endotoxin detection. Then molecular detection methods are available for diagnosing tubercular meningitis by doing this PCR, Mycobacterium tuberculosis specific genes, IS6110. Is there by using those primers, you can detect Mycobacterium tuberculosis etiology for tuberculosis meningitis. So what treatment you give? Pyogenic meningitis is suspected empirically to adults. You can start intravenous ceftriaxone or ceftriaxone and vancomycin. If listeria is suspected, you can give IV ampicillin. For neonates, IV ampicillin plus gentamicin is included. IV dexamethasone is added to reduce intracranial pressure. Steroids are given to reduce the intracranial pressure. Definitive therapy when you will give after the culture report is available. This empirically you can start with cephalosporins and vancomycin. In case of listeria, you can start empirically, you can start ampicillin. But after culture report, you can start the correct treatment after the antibiotic sensitivity testing. You get the correct drugs with the organism sensitive to those drugs. You get only after the antibiotic sensitivity testing, then you can start the proper treatment. For tubercular meningitis, according to following RNTCP guidelines, you can go with the drugs for tuberculosis meningitis. For cryptococcal meningitis, you can in induction phase, we give amphotericin B, flucytosine for 2 to 4 weeks, and maintenance is done with fluconazole for 6 to 12 months. For viral meningitis, antiviral drugs like IV acyclovir is given. Okay. That's all. That is about meningitis. Thank you.